Do you feel the world is broken?
We do.
Do you feel the shadows deepen?
We do.
But do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through?
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all?
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Mount Isa Baptist Church. So those of you that came last night, I'm sure you'll agree it was a really wonderful occasion. And those of you that didn't, you should be jealous because you missed out on a great evening. I'd like to invite you to stand and sing with us our first song this morning.
Don't drop a single anchor, we're almost home. Through every toil and danger, we're almost home. How many pilgrim saints have before us gone? No stopping now, we're almost home. This land is calling, we're almost home. And not a tear shall fall then, we're almost home. Make ready now your souls for that kingdom come. No turning back, we're almost home. Almost home. This journey ours together, we're almost home. Unto that great forever, we're almost home. What song and you will sing round that happy throne? Come faint of heart, we're almost home. Almost home, we're almost home. Is just a vapor, we're almost home. That sun is setting yonder, we're almost home. Take courage, for this darkness shall break to dawn. Oh, lift your eyes, we're almost home. Almost home. Praise the Lord, we're almost home. We're almost home. We're almost home. So press on toward that blessed shore. Praise the Lord, we're almost home.
Pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for our time here together today. We thank you that we can gather together as brothers and sisters in Christ and worship you and praise you together. We pray for our children's ministries, that they will be, good instruction to our children, and they'll be attentive and engaging with all the things that their teachers are teaching them today. And we thank you for those that have volunteered their time to help to instruct our children. We pray for our service today and for Pastor Tim as he brings his message, and we pray that it will be your words, Lord, that are coming through him as he teaches and instructs us. And we pray for these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. This is one the kids might like. There might be some actions, guys. Yeah?
Be strong and courageous, the Lord of the ages holds all his little ones safe by his side. Be strong and courageous, the Lord of the ages holds all his little ones safe. Do not fear the fire,
do not fear the fire,
do not fear the water.
Do not fear the water.
Do not fear the thunder.
Do not fear the thunder.
Jesus has conquered them all. Be strong and courageous. The Lord of the ages holds all his little ones safe by his side. Be strong and courageous. The Lord of the ages holds all his little ones safe. Do not fear the darkness.
Do not fear the darkness.
Do not fear the sadness.
Do not fear the sadness.
Do not fear the sickness.
Do not fear the sickness.
Jesus has conquered them all. Be strong and courageous. The Lord of the strong and courageous, the Lord of the ages holds all his little ones safe. Do not fear the enemy.
Do not fear the enemy.
Do not fear the poverty.
Do not fear the poverty.
Do not fear eternity.
Do not fear eternity.
Jesus has conquered them all. Be strong and courageous. The Lord of the ages holds all his little ones safe by his side. Be strong and courageous. The Lord of the ages holds all his little ones safe.
Please take a seat. I'll run through our announcements. So next Sunday will be our last week with the Beard family. So we will be having a morning tea to farewell them and wish them well before they head off on their next trip to South Sudan. So please bring a plate to share for morning tea. Next Saturday will also be the Fun Time Toy Exchange. If you would like to get rid of any unwanted toys and switch them with something else, please come along to the top hall at 10 a.m. and there will also be some baked goods for sale. And next Sunday afternoon, the leaders for the Friendship Cruise, which is our kids' holiday program, are asked to come and help with setting up for the program. If you are able to help, please come to the hall between 1:30 and 2:30 to help organising the setup for that. I'll hand over to Tim.
Good morning, everyone. It's good to have you here, especially if you're a visitor or a guest. It's wonderful to see you. Trust that the service will be helpful for your life and faith. We've had a quick change of plan. I was expecting Dave not to be here. Dave rang me yesterday to say that he had a hemorrhage in his eye. Is that I was going to pray for him and his health, but if he was here, we were going to welcome him into membership along with Ruth. So you guys are here, so we can welcome you into membership and pray for your eye at the same time. So I'd invite you to come up and we'll pray for you and welcome you in. And it's been encouraging. We have said goodbye to a few people this year, but we've also welcomed in 7 people into membership within the last few months. So that's been an encouragement to us. And I want to acknowledge Dave and Ruth and thank you for your friendship to us, for the encouragement that you've been as you've come here Sunday after Sunday and in various other things to worship alongside and service. Just thank you for your gentleness and your kindness, your example to us. And also thank you for Dave for the encouragement I'm sure you are to Ruth and the responsibility you've taken in marriage and taking on Empress and Ruth is in your family as well. So we just want to encourage you in that as well. Let me pray for you. Lord, we acknowledge you as the Father of glory, without equal or match, and we thank you that you've called us to be your church, individuals who make up the body of Christ. We thank you that you love us, that you've given yourself up for us, and we acknowledge that Christ is the head of the church, and it's our desire to follow him and to bring him glory. We thank you for the work of salvation that you've done in the lives of David and Ruth. We thank you that they love you and your church. We thank you for being able to gather with them in worship, in service, in your name. And we pray that as they commit themselves in this way, that you would please help them grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ. Help them know and serve in the areas of their spiritual gifts, and grant them wisdom to help with the various decisions and challenges that this church will face. I ask that you would help them be godly husband and wife to each other, protect their marriage and make it stronger, and help them be godly parents to Empress and help them disciple her to also follow Jesus. We pray that Empress would grow to love you and love your word. Help David and Ruth in their places of work as well. May they be witnesses to the gospel in their lives and in their words. We thank you for that you've placed them in this church and for the encouragement they bring. We praise your son Jesus, who is head of the church. Amen. Now, before you sit down, I'll pray for your health. And Christine, you've got surgery next week as well. Would you be agreeable to come up here and we might pray for you as well? And perhaps I'll invite Gary and Ben and we just might pray for both David and Christine as well. So Christine's flying to Townsville for surgery in her leg. So we'll pray for both of these couple. Lord, we lift up to you David and Christine and just acknowledge their current need in both Christine's surgery coming up this week. Lord, we pray that you might grant her peace of mind and gifted hands, skilled hands with the doctors and nurses that will be undertaking the surgery. Lord, we pray that for a good and quick and speedy outcome as well. Lord, we also lift up Dave and the issues that he's currently facing in with his eye. Lord, again, we pray that you might be gracious to him, help him persevere through this challenge, and even that you might be gracious to him and grant him a speedy recovery as well. Lord, be with them, help them persevere through these challenges, and help them look to Jesus Christ for hope and help. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Good, thanks, guys. I think we can invite Christy back up.
All right, it's time for the kids to head out. So if you are in kindy up to grade 3, you'll be heading up to the hall for Sunshine Corner. Is there junior church this morning? No, no junior church this morning. But there's some worksheets in the meeting room for junior church kids to grab and complete. Can I please ask our stewards to take up the offering as well before we sing our next song? If you're a visitor and you haven't come prepared to contribute today, please don't feel obligated and let the bag just pass on by. Please stand and sing with us.
Create in me a clean heart, oh God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, oh God, and renew a right spirit within me. Joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, oh God, and renew a right spirit within me. Joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me, and renew a right spirit within me. Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. Body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, Up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns. The power of Christ I stand.
Please take a seat. John wants to sing a solo for us. Can I welcome Boy up to share the Bible reading, and then we'll hand over to Pastor Tim for his message.
Yeah, good morning. Okay, we'll be reading from Ephesians 4, verses 17 through to 19. So this I say, therefore, and testify in the Lord, that you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk, in their futility of their mind, having their understanding darkened, because alienated, or being alienated from the life of God, because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the blindness of their heart, who, being past feeling, have given themselves over to lewdness, to work all uncleanliness with greediness.
Thanks, boy. Good, thank you, boy, and thank you, Christy. Let me pray. Well, Father, help us delight in your word today. Help us store it in our hearts so that we wouldn't sin against you. Make us wise and bring us life, we pray. Amen. Well, approximately 390 AD, St. Ambrose gave some advice to St. Augustine that loosely translates to the following: when in Rome, do as the Romans do. You've probably heard that said before, and I was surprised to trace it back to, in fact, Ambrose giving that advice to Augustine. And Ambrose was telling Augustine how, when he went to Rome, that he would observe the customs of the church, even though they were different from the customs of his own church. You know that when you go to a different church, things are a little bit different, they do things different, and what do? Do you kick up a stink, or do you observe the customs? It's good contextual advice. When you go into a new culture, to adapt and to learn that culture, the language, if it's not ungodly, if there's things that aren't ungodly, they can be received and adapted to help maintain unity and cohesion and friendships. Now, this might be good advice in many circumstances, but not always so, because here Paul tells Christians not to walk as the Gentiles do. When with the Gentiles, don't do as the Gentiles do. Or another way to say that makes sense is to say, when in the world, don't act worldly. To live as the Gentiles do or as the world does wouldn't be Christian conduct. In fact, it would be fatal to your soul. Now, the Christians in Ephesus had once lived this way, had once lived as the Gentiles did. They were formerly pagans in a pagan city that worshipped idols and lived according to the standards of the kingdom of the world, the old world that they lived in. And in verse 19, Paul calls out some of those standards that they formerly lived by. He says that you formerly lived in your sensuality, in your greed, in your impurity. And so this is basic Christianity, and it makes sense in every area of our life not to live, although we live in the world, not to live worldly lives. You think about when you go into the sports field, follow the rules of the game. When you're at work, follow the procedures of the place of your work. And when you're at a barbecue, don't put barbecue sauce on your steak. We understand the basic rules of this world, especially if you come to barbecue at my house and we have tomato sauce there. It's a test, right? It's a test. If you confess Christ, then live as Christ would have you live in this world. That makes sense to us, doesn't it? And so we begin today in chapter 17, and it's a new section in Paul's letter. And Paul's really his final section of this letter and the final section of his application. Paul has just stressed the need for unity. If you were here last night, you would have heard Dave speak on that passage, chapters 4, 1 to 6, about the unity in the church, and how he's also stressed the need for Christian character to help maintain unity in the church. And this application to us really flows from the teaching of what we've already seen in chapters 1 to 3. The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit have spared nothing in their desire to bring about their plan of salvation. And in response to all that the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit have done to us, we need to live our lives before our Maker. Meaning practically that your life will be godly, that your life will be holy, that your life will be obedient and pure. And we must be intentional to strive for this type of life. Christians are people who know how to truly live. We have divine revelation. We are not a people who are left without a word. We have divine revelation from God, from a personal triune God. Now, this is in contrast to much of the world around us, of other ways of knowing, of other systems of knowing that have as their foundation perhaps an impersonal God, impersonal gods who don't speak as God has spoken, or an impersonal time and chance that doesn't have objective reality, a God, a creator and personal God behind all, how and or what we believe. Schaefer says it well like this. In government and in morals, the objective base is gone and the hedonistic subjective whims of a 51% majority or an elite are all that is left. Only sociological averages and arbitrary judgments remain. This is what's left if we don't have faith in a creator God. And we've seen this unfold in recent years. You think back to 2017, a postal vote was held to determine how we should understand marriage. And the vote was above 51% in favor of change. But the Christians say, well, no, there is a higher law. Morality isn't based on my opinion, on my feelings, on the consensus of what people think around me. It's not based on a desire to excuse my sin. Rather, the Lord has fixed his moral will into creation, and my life is best lived when I subject my life according to his law. Again, this makes sense to us. I hope it does. If there is a personal God who created us, who cares for us, then it's logical that he would create categories for right and wrong living. And why would he do that? Well, he's our creator. He knows what's best for us. He knows how we should live. Now, I imagine you've experienced this personally when you have lived outside of these categories, when you've caused damage to yourself, to others, when you've broken that relationship between you and God, when you have exceeded his boundaries for living. Perhaps in anger, in greed, in misplaced sexuality, in your untruthfulness, you go outside of God's standards and you hurt yourself. You hurt others as well. David wrote these simple words in Psalm 119. For your rules are good. For your rules are good. And how did David know that the Lord's rules are good? He had to learn that the hard way, didn't he? You think of his affair with Bathsheba. He killed Bathsheba's husband Uriah to cover it up. And as you read in 2 Samuel, David's life and his family became more difficult because he exceeded the boundaries of God's good design. And David had that personal perspective to look at the seventh command of you shall not commit adultery and say, that's a good rule. There's a reason God gave me and us that rule, because I've had to learn the consequences of that the hard way. And the same could be said of all of God's commands as well, that they are good and given to us for a reason. And so we should remember that Christians have a reason to live godly lives. This is a type of living, of self-governance, of morality that promotes happiness, success, unity in families and communities. Now, non-Christians can, of course, live moral, self-governed lives and that reap the benefit of God's law. But Christians, of all people, have a reason to live according to the Lord's standards, because we believe something. We believe that Christ has done something for us of incredible value, of incredible worth, that Jesus Christ has bled and died for us. And in light of this, being obedient shouldn't be a bore, a drudgery, something that we don't enjoy doing. It should be our joy and passion to live God's way in God's world. To not live God's way dishonors our King. You know, have you thought of your sin that way? You know, not simply in right and wrong, or that God is an angry judge ready to bear down on us, but Christ has died for our sin and that He deserves a certain type of life, that when you're about to do something or commit yourself to exceeding His boundary, have you ever thought that my King Jesus deserves so much more from me because of what He has done? You know, if I were to turn to addiction, to gambling, to alcohol, to pornography, if I failed to keep my character in check and I become a gossip or a liar to let my anger run, you know, I not only hurt my immediate family, my wife, my children, but I grieve the Holy Spirit who lives inside of me. So this is why we need doctrine, so that we know what our King expects of us, so that we can live a certain type of life. This is what our King desires, how we should live. So we jump back to our passage. And notice that Paul doesn't immediately implore Christians to live holy lives. We'll get to that in the next few weeks, but he doesn't immediately implore us to live holy or obedient lives. Rather, he first shines a spotlight on the world around us. And what does he point out? If you have your Bible in front of you, look at verse 17 and 18, and just have a look at those things that Paul points out in the world around us. He says that the world around us is futile in their thinking, that the world around us is darkened in their understanding, and that the world around us is separated from the life of God. And you notice a common theme there about the intellect or the mind, the understanding. Paul says that how the world thinks is fundamental to its actions. You know, why can't the world around us act properly? And Paul says it's because it can't think rightly. The world persists in sin because of its futile thinking, its pointless thinking, which has darkened its understanding. The problem, Paul says, is immediately or firstly in the mind, both individually, as individuals turn away from God, which then collectively as nations turn away from God. The unsaved person doesn't think according to the categories of God's good law. As David mentioned before, your laws are good, God set His law, this is how we're to act. the world around us doesn't think that way and largely has no higher objective than itself, and so everything is disordered. And reading what Paul says about the worldly mind would have been countercultural then. Could you imagine if Paul said to many of the Greeks that were around him, or the Romans, you know, your thinking is disordered. That would have been completely countercultural. It would have caused people to come against Paul in incredible ways, because you might think, you know, the advancements in government, in society, that the Greek world advanced in. The Greeks, that world, that Greek-Roman world that Paul lived in, was an advanced civilization. You might think of some of the, if I asked you, can you name some of the Greek philosophers? You'd likely be able to name some. Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, Archimedes. The Greeks were known as the sharpest thinkers that have ever lived. But in all of their advancements, Paul says, as he stands in that world, the world around us, their thinking has a major flaw in it. And like today, the Greeks believed that intellect could find the solution to their problems. And again, today, like the Greeks, we have a highly educated population, advancements in so many areas. But you think, is the world becoming more ordered? Or does it remain in that same disordered state that Paul found himself in? And Scripture tells us here that the ungodly world has a futile mind, that it's darkened in their understanding and is separated from God. Now, some things, of course, are getting better. Developments in health and technology. My first car was a 1994 Corolla, and it had a cassette player. And I thought it was a significant advancement when I could plug a USB, when I changed the head unit of my car so I could plug in a USB. That was amazing. And then we got my new car that I only got a few years ago. I could stream straight from Bluetooth. That was an incredible advancement. So, you know, how can anyone top this? And you might remember connecting to the internet 20 years ago and hearing your modem make a funny sound as you connected, the sound. And now we walk around with high-speed internet in our pockets. So lots of advancements, isn't there? But Paul still says there is a fatal flaw in the thinking of the world. We're advancing in many areas, but if we don't acknowledge God, our worldview, the way that we look at the world, will be ungodly. Our center for living will be off. The world around us doesn't have categories for sin, for salvation, for eternal hope, for godly living. They put those elsewhere. And I believe that if that's your perspective, no eternal God, no objective truth, all you are left with is, if you're honest, is despair and the certain expectation of death. In fact, that is what Bertrand Russell, the atheist, he was an honest atheist, he said that if that's your worldview, all we are left with is unyielding despair. Now, there's a second truth here as well. So not only is the unbelieving world, the mind of the unbelieving world, futile, but Paul says there's another reason why it is the way it is. He says in verse 18, due to the hardness of their heart. And the word for hardening here is used in Greek literature for stone. It's also used for the word callous. If you're a guitar player, I tried to play guitar for a few weeks many years ago, and as soon as you start on the frets, your fingers get very sore, and you've got to push through to develop calluses. When we lived on the sunny coast, we used to do a lot of windsurfing, and holding the boom, you get calluses all up your hands. And the more you went out, the stronger the calluses would get, and you could do it for a lot longer, and it wouldn't bother you. And what Paul wants us to know is that the unbelieving world is like that, has become hardened, has made itself hard, and is to blame for their situation. People have willfully hardened themselves against God, and the consequence is that they become warped in their spiritual understanding. Now, you might think of another part of Paul's letters where he makes this same argument in Romans chapter 1. Paul makes this same argument, and he did that several years earlier before writing to the church in Ephesians. If you know that chapter, starting from chapter 8, verse 18 in chapter 1, Paul explains how the wrath, the righteous anger of God is revealed against ungodly people. Not because they are innocently ignorant of God, but because they have willfully closed their eyes to God's revelation. The four main points in Romans chapter 1. The first is that God has, in fact, revealed himself in the world around us. When the world around us sees the created world, they see his attributes, they see the attributes of God, they see the power of God. And Paul says, for what can be known about God is plain to them because God has shown it to them. And so Paul says God's power, his nature, his attributes are clearly seen in the created world. And so everyone is without an excuse. Hopefully you know this when you go out camping and you see the stars in the sky, the colors of the mountains. You should think, this is an incredible world that the Lord has created. This gives evidence that there is something beyond what we cannot see. Now, looking at creation doesn't bring us knowledge about the saving work of Jesus. Creation, of course, doesn't tell us everything. It's limited, but it's nonetheless real revelation of God and sufficient to lead a person to worship, to say, there is a God, he's created me, and to be in awe and reverence of this creator God. And so for a person to refuse what God has made plain about himself in creation is enough to be a blameworthy offense and to bring God's righteous anger. And next in Romans, although we have enough revelation about God to worship him, Paul says that people have suppressed or rejected that revelation. Verse 18, men who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. That's people hide the truth away. They deny the truth. Have you ever been in a pool with a beach ball and you try and shove it underwater and it just wants to pop out? This is the picture that Paul gives us, that men and women outside of Christ are intentionally putting the truth down, and it's a very hard job to keep it there. If they acknowledge that God is their creator, what would happen is that beach ball would fly out from out of the water, and they would have to change the way they live. They would have to turn to him in faith. But rather than change, Paul says that they keep suppressing it. They keep it down so they don't have to deal with that truth. And next, because of that ignorance of God, because the ignorance of God is intentional and a cause for blame, Paul says that God's wrath is upon the unbelieving world. That is, God doesn't look at the unbelieving world with favor, but rather they are objects of wrath. And fourth, Paul speaks about how God judges people who are willfully ignore him. The judgment comes, of course, as we know, at the end of the age, but it also comes now as the Lord allows sin to run its course. Coming back to Augustine, as I mentioned at the start, Augustine said that the punishment of sin is sin, being handed over to live in the destruction of sin is one of God's judgments. Do you know that? As we turn away from God and left to the consequences of our sin, we find out what it's really like to live without God. And in this letter to the Ephesians, Paul describes how the world has been given over to sin in a number of ways. If you go back to the passage, Paul highlights three things that the world has been given over to: sensuality, to impurity, and to greediness. Well, the first there is sensuality, that is, men and women have abandoned themselves to sin, living without conscience, living without morality, with an unquenchable lust, bringing what should be kept in private out into the open. Well, next, Paul also says that the world has been given over to impurity. That is, all the distortion of moral life, so that everything in the world becomes foul, that nothing remains sacred or special. And you think, well, why wouldn't the world behave this way? The last several generations have seen the worst kinds of immorality, on the internet and on TV. sin is normalized. You know, if you talk to a number of our teachers here, they'll talk about the pornography that is shared openly in the schoolyards, devastating a new generation. There's no sacredness to sexuality. Normalizing this next generation to live as though this is completely normal. And last, Paul mentions greediness. That means that nothing matters more than myself. That's what it is to be a greedy person. I matter the most. I must have what I want, and I must have more of what I want. And nothing can come in between what I want. And so hardness of heart and futility of mind manifests itself in these ways of sensuality, of impurity, and of greediness. And all of that has a price to pay if we remain in those unrepentant. Now, Paul is not saying that every person without God is like this, that every person is as evil as they could possibly be all the time, but it's a picture of life without Christ as a whole. This is where life descends to as we depart from God's objective truth. And praise God, it's out of this type of life that you and I have been saved. And just as Lot was commanded not to look back on as destruction rained down on Sodom and Gomorrah, we shouldn't look back on the destructiveness of our sin, of our old lives, but rather, just as we've come here this morning, we should praise the Lord for his wonderful salvation. And Paul says, in the midst of this world, keep your feet dry and clean and have nothing to do with this old kind of thinking. Don't live as the world does, but live as Christ would have you live. Well, what Paul has described here is the world that we live in. We live in today as well. All restraints, I think you'd agree, are largely gone. The worst possible sins are practiced in the open. Now, next time we meet, Paul will explain what it means to no longer live the way the Gentiles do and explain this in the positive aspect of how we are to live. But just closing with a few conclusions and applications from these verses. And the first is this. Do you see the world as Paul sees it, and in fact the way that God sees it? That we live in a world of tremendous advancements, of tremendous wealth. The world around us probably sees itself as doing rather well. But God's perspective is that this world is hard, is darkened, is ignorant in the most important matter in its relationship between us and God. And because of that, it's given itself over to the worst of sins. And lacking this knowledge, as the restraints of the Christian consensus are gone, it becomes increasingly wicked. And one thing that this world needs is knowledge. And to start with our children, to teach them that there is a God who has created and ordered this world, to teach our children that there is a God who loves them and who sent his Son to die for them in their sin. Have you considered how you can teach others about this good news, particularly children? Have you considered, are there ways I can teach children in my life, in my family, in the community, about God to overcome this futility of mind? Perhaps in brigades or Sunday school, in RI? But throughout history, Christians have placed an important emphasis on teaching the younger generations, often being the people who started schools so that children can become aware and read God's word to overcome this darkness. And we do this so that our children aren't ignorant, so that by the grace of God, their futile minds, their hard hearts, might be overcome with the grace and the gospel of God. And so we don't underestimate, as Christians, the need for Christian teaching and education. This is one of our primary tasks, to teach, to overcome the futility of mind in the world around us. This is our commission to make disciples, and we do that how? Well, by baptizing men and women and by teaching them all that Christ has commanded. What Paul has spoken about here, this futility, this hardness of heart, this ignorance, are overcome by teaching that comes from the Word of God, so that this is a good place to put your time and your effort into. This is a good place to put your resources into, teaching younger generations and older generations, if you have capacity to do so, teaching them to overcome this ignorance of mind that has come because of sin. A second, these verses here force us to recognize the spiritual blindness that is in the world. Now, William Wilberforce, that man who devoted his life to the abolition of slavery, tells a short story of one of his friends. His friend, this particular friend, was named William Pitt, who was eventually one of the prime ministers of England. And William, of course, was a genuine Christian. But William Pitt was a Christian in name only. And William Wilberforce was impressed by a preaching of a particular man by the name of Richard Cecil, who was an evangelical Anglican or Church of England man at the time. And William found himself to be spiritually fed under this man's preaching. And he wanted to take his friend William Pitt along to hear, but William Pitt would often decline. But one day he eventually accepted. And on this day, William Wilberforce recounts that this pastor preached an exceptional sermon. And Wilberforce was left in awe and in wonder. But when the service entered and the two men left the facility or the building, Pitt turned to Wilberforce and said, "You know, Wilberforce, I have not the slightest idea what that man was talking about." And perhaps you've had a similar experience with your own family and friends. We should be deeply saddened by family who remain in darkness, but not surprised that they're there. Do you pray for mums and dads, brothers and sisters who are outside of Christ nightly? My wife and I do. We make sure we pray for people in our life and family members who don't know Christ. But this is what Paul is talking about here, this idea of having a futile mind and having a hard heart. A person remains that way until God intervenes and softens their heart and opens their eyes. And finally, from now on to the end of Ephesians, we'll see what Paul means when he says that we're not to live like the Gentiles. That's Paul's intention, to apply all that he said in chapters 1 to 3 to our lives so that we live differently. But although we can't live like them, the world around us, although we reject a worldview that says there is no God, there is no objective truth, we have a duty, a Christian duty, to the unbelieving world around us. And that is, we are called to pray for the world. And perhaps we don't even know where to start. How do we start praying for an unbelieving world? Perhaps pray for specific people in your life, that the Lord would be gracious to them and open their eyes to the glories of the gospel. Now, we can't know for certain if the Lord will save or won't save a person, but the Bible tells us to pray. It says that we don't receive because we don't ask. Great things in history, in the church, in individual lives have always come at the end of fervent prayer. And so do you believe that? Do you believe it enough to pray that the good Lord would overcome someone's darkness, overcome a hard heart, intervene in someone's mind and heart to overcome that? This is what we must do. We must pray. We must teach. These are the primary means that the Lord has given us in this battle against futile minds and hard hearts, teaching and prayer, so that those issues might be overcome. And we pray that in the name of God, for His glory. Well, let me pray. Father, we thank You for Your word to us today. We thank You that we have this letter that tells us not only what You've done, but also how You require us to live and how not to live. We pray You would help us to no longer desire to walk according to our old life, motivated by the desires of our flesh, given to sensuality, to greed, to impurity. We'd ask that You would put to death the old man in our lives and help us to live in newness of life, purchased by our Savior Jesus. We pray that for our community, that You might grant repentance and faith to many people, and that many people in our community would desire to turn away from that old life of sensuality, of greediness, of impurity. Help us as individuals and our ministries to be a godly witness. Lord, we do lift up our children, as we've just spoken about today, that there's a great need to train them in discipline, in discipleship, to help overcome the futility of mind in their own lives, and to help them submit to your will and to leave their old life behind. I'll be with those in our church today who are sick or distressed and in need of your perfect peace. Help them persevere through life's trials and sanctify us as a church. Help us love and obey your word for the sake of your Son, Jesus. Amen. And of course, if you find yourself in that place today where you would say, I am in a place of having a futile mind and a hardened heart, then of course you're welcome to come and speak to me, to Ben, to Gary, and we'd be more than happy to pray for you in that situation. Thank you, Christy.
Please stand and sing our last song with us. Christ is my reward and all of my devotion. Now there's nothing in this world that could ever satisfy. Through every trial, my soul will sing. This hope will never fail. Heaven is our home. Through every trial, my soul will sing. Jesus is here. To God be the glory.
To follow Jesus, no turning back.
turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back, no turning back. No turning back, no turning back. No turning back, no turning back.
Thank you very much for joining us today. Hope you'll have a great week. And before you go today, if you get the chance to wish Vanessa a happy birthday, make sure you do so.